This Yui-chan with everyone is wearing a top and bottom. In other words, the top and bottom are separate objects, not one object. So how did I make these characters and costumes move? Let's figure it out now. We use the Animator component to play or transition our characters' animations. An Animator component is applied to each top and bottom that the character is wearing. These Animator components use an Animator applied to the character's body. Now let's run the game and see what happens when the character's animation transitions. It is confirmed that the basic pose animation plays well. However, when switching to animation, only Yui-chan's body is changed to a walking animation, while the costume retains its default pose. The reason this happens is because the animation transition is done only on Yui-chan's body. So, many people choose to change the parameters after accessing the Animator component of each costume. We can see that the animation transitions of all objects work well. It's not bad to use this method, but if we have a lot of clothes to wear, the number of codes for the animation transition will increase. In addition, it can also affect performance due to unnecessary code growth. Now, let's think of a more efficient way. First, let's take a look at cube, which can be easily seen in Unity. The shape of the cube can be drawn on the screen through the mesh renderer applied to the cube. But what about objects connected to bones? Unlike cube, the character object has skinned mesh renderer applied. This means that the vertices of the 3D object are connected to the bones so that they can be moved. In this way, Unity automatically determines which type of renderer to apply based on whether an object has bones or not. The costumes use the bones connected to the character's body as they are. In other words, since the body and each costume are connected with the same skeleton, wouldn't it be possible to apply the information of the skeleton used in the body to the costume? This is the core and principle of today's tutorial. Now let's apply this principle to our character's costume. Let's create a new script. I named this script Costume Bone Reset. The update function is not needed in this script. First of all, we need to create a skinned mesh renderer variable that we need to reference. Next, we need to store all bones referenced by that skinned mesh renderer in variables. Since we need to store not only bones but also the names of the bones, we will use the dictionary variable. The key should be the name of the bone, and the value should be the transform of the bone. The dictionary variable name will be bone map. Now let's use a for each loop to retrieve all the bones used by the target object and store them in the dictionary variable. Next, we need to create a skinned mesh renderer variable to get and store from the cloth. You can see that the mesh of the costume is the second child from the parent object. After finding that object, we'll save the skinned mesh renderer component to a variable. I will create an array variable to store the bones associated with the costume, and then specify the length of this array in terms of the number of bones. It looks like we are now ready to replace the bones attached to the costume. We will need to run loop statements as the number of bones in the costume. Each time the loop statement is executed, the bones connected to the costume must be stored in temporary variables one by one in order. Next, we use the dictionary's tryGetValue function to find the bone in the bone map based on the name of the bone applied to the costume. The bone found is returned to the new bones variable we created earlier. Finally, apply this variable to the skinned mesh renderer's bones property of the costume and we are done. However, there are some things to go through before applying this script to the costume. The number of bones or the names to be replaced may be different. If that happens, an error will surely occur when playing the game. To prevent this problem in advance, we will add a simple conditional statement. If the information of the bones connected to both objects is different, this loop will stop immediately. Now let's apply this script to two costumes. The animator component applied to the cloth is no longer required. Next, let's apply the previously completed script to the costume. All that remains is to apply the skinned mesh renderer we need to reference to a public variable. I will select Yui-chan's body and store it in a variable. Let's apply the same to the bottom as the top. The last thing to do is to remove the animation transition code written for testing purposes. Now let's run the game and see what the results will be together. It is confirmed that the animation transition of the character's body and clothes is well done. Even though neither costume has an animator component, we can see the animation playing. Just in case, I will apply one condition and finish. As we saw earlier, the assets to which skinned mesh renderer is applied consist of this. However, depending on the 3D modeling tool, the structure and name may be slightly different. Therefore, when hierarchies are created in alphabetical order, the order of the hierarchies may differ depending on the name. We only need one object with skinned mesh renderer applied to it, so we need to make a fallback for that. Now let's create conditions. The code in that line is made for my own 3D assets, so I'll comment out that code. Since the object to which skinned mesh renderer is applied contains at least two children, we first need to know the number of children of the object. We'll run a loop, and if a skinned mesh renderer is found, we'll save that component to a variable and then stop the loop. Let's run the game again and see if the animation works correctly. We can see that all functions are working perfectly.